Here we go. We have presenter number one. Are we ready? Presenter number one.
So I'm discussing temperature regulation in sheep. So sheep grow thick layers of wool that helps protect them from the hot and cold weather conditions. And this is just due to the insulating properties of the wool. And it's believed that sheep with 1 inch of fleece are more comfortable than sheep with less than 1 inch of fleece because the wool acts to dissipate the heat, which will keep in cooler temperatures for their body. And then sheep have more surface air exposed, so they're more susceptible to these harsher weather conditions. So another mechanism that sheep use to control their temperature is the countercurrent heat exchange. So when the hypothalamus is hot, the body reacts by basically panting, which allows the animal to lose heat through evaporation. And this involves the loss of water, but preserving water would be extremely important in these warmer conditions, so losing a lot of it will be detrimental to their survival. So sheep use the countercurrent heat exchange to avoid all of this by firstly cooling the hypothalamus. And this happens through the use of the carotid rete. And it's located in the sinus at the base of the brain. So the way this works is that cool venous blood from the nasal mucosa drains into the cavernous sinus via the angular aculi vein.
You're doing good.
And then it passes through to the carotid vein. And then from the other angle, the carotid artery carries hot blood from the heart, and then it branches through the carotid rete. And the heat is transferred from the hot blood to the cool blood to ensure a proper blood temperature before reaching the brain. And then the blood then cools off the hypothalamus, which creates a difference between the body and brain temperatures, and it also decreases the amount of water lost. So an example from a study that I read about, they said that by using the countercurrent heat system for 50% of the day, a 50 kilogram sheep could save 2.6 liters of water, which is about 60% of their daily intake. And then if the system is used for 80% of the day, then that could be as high as saving 3.5 liters of water.
And where are they saving the water at? I think I've never missed that.
Just like in the body, just the intake. I know they're just not losing it through evaporation from sweating and such.
Okay. Okay, remember, we're partners, but you can sit down. Okay, first of all, this is an incredible diagram. And so I'm going to go through it and make some more points. And first thing you should notice is there's three heat transfer mechanisms occurring simultaneously in this diagram. So that's pretty good because there's really only four that we really need to worry about. And there's three of them operating simultaneously. So I think previous to this, we've said animals are complicated because vessels can change in size, and I'm going to show you that also here. It's not like an engine where everything is fixed and there's so many, it's a certain temperature all the time and conductivity can't change with any metal. But anyway, so animals are incredibly complicated. And so hopefully you entitled this the ovine carotid rete. Okay, now carotid rete is up there, up near the ear there. And ovine is an adjective meaning sheep, right? So the ovine carotid rete is a great example of how the brain can be cooled in hot environments. And I think camels do this as well, and some animals don't do this at all. Okay, don't have this mechanism. So let me start out. Of course, the jugular vein is very famous because it drains bilaterally the head. So if you ever want to collect any blood that has pituitary hormones, or hypothalamic hormones, especially the pituitary hormones, you would take a jugular blood sample, not a carotid artery sample. Because here's the carotid artery. The carotid artery has taken blood circulating through the whole body and it's bringing it up to the brain. And so if you sampled the carotid artery, it'd have very low amounts of pituitary hormones. Unlike the jugular vein, would have the highest concentration of pituitary hormones because it hasn't been diluted in the body yet. So sometimes you do studies And like when we take jugular blood samples, we know we can measure LH, FSH, ACTH, anything coming from the pituitary gland, okay? In its highest concentrations. So here's the nasal cavity. And so there's air going to be, and then of course we don't see the airways here. So that's one thing that's lacking. You don't see the turbinates of the nasal cavity. But there's a lot of surface area in the nasal cavity. And that's where moisture is going to be evaporating. Okay, so when the moisture evaporates, of course, that's a latent heat transfer mechanism. I'm trying to get you guys prepped up for the exam on Wednesday. It will cool the tissue that's surrounding these vessels, and then these vessels are going to cool because of the respiration and the evaporation. When I get done with this, we're going to go through the factors that mainly affect conduction, convection, radiation, and evaporation. And you'll know that if it's very humid out, then there won't be that much evaporation. So this works better the less humidity there is. And so whenever anything is evaporating, the lower humidity that's possible, the better evaporation works. And, you know, we don't get into it much in this class, but, you know, when you design buildings, you got to know what's the relative humidity that's out there in the summertime. Like in Arizona, they have what's called swamp coolers. At least years ago, it used to be very famous to see this box on top of houses. And if you ever get there and you go to the older parts of like Tucson or Phoenix, you'll see what's called a swamp cooler. It's a box on top of a house, and all it is a sponge-filled box that has water running over it. And the air that's brought in, remember it's hot, but it's very low humidity, it evaporates that water and cools the air as it comes in. Very efficient. But like when I lived in Nebraska, they had very few of those because in the summer it's hot, but it's so humid, the swamp cooler can't work. Okay? So anyway, this is evaporating, this blood is cool, and now the first thing I want you to notice, there's a fork in the road. Right there. Wasn't it Robert Frost, I took the path less traveled by and has made all the difference? Well, this fork can change size. And when a blood vessel can change size, it's called shunting. So if you don't want to cool the brain, if you don't need it, this vessel right here constricts. Right there. If it constricts, then more blood is going to go down the jugular vein without going through this mechanism, right? So that's shunting. If you're very hot and you need the brain cool, this vessel dilates and this one constricts. Okay? So it's kind of like, where is it needed? Remember, this is pretty cool blood. I'm not sure what it is, but I'm sure somebody has measured it at one point. So let's say we don't need to cool the brain much. So a lot of the blood is going to be diverted here. I don't know the percent, but more is going to go down this way. And you're going to go down the jugular. And of course, what is the next vessel that the jugular gets into? The jugular will connect to the vena cava. And that goes into what chamber of the heart? Right atrium. Thank you. Okay, but let's say we do need to cool the brain. Now we're going to go this way. Now here's what's interesting. You've got the hot blood from the body, the carotid artery coming up, and notice what it does. It branches out, and this diagram doesn't do it any justice. Think of this branching, but multiplied by 100. So you get all these little vessels, and when anything branches a lot, it's called a rete. It could be a nerve too, but in this case it's a blood vessel. So blood vessels are going to branch out a lot, and then it's going to come back together and then go to the brain. But one thing that it does when it branches, it increases its surface area for conduction manyfold. Now notice the blue blood is surrounding the carotid rete, because this the blue blood is cooler, so we're going to get heat transfer from the red to the blue at every point of contact. So then the blood that does get to the brain is definitely cooler than this blood. So like if you took this temperature and this temperature, definitely cooler. So, and just another way of this, and then this is this whole, this blue thing, this big room, I'll say, is called this cavernous sinus. And a sinus is a big area filled with something. Notice I didn't say air. It could be blood or air. In this case, it's blood. So to give you another example, think of this room as the cavernous sinus. It's full of cool venous blood. Then think of these brown supports here as the carotid rete, but put 1,000 of these in this room, these brown pillars. Look at how much surface area. And the brown pillars are full of arterial blood, the carotid rete blood. So then you've got this big surface area where heat is going to transfer from the inside of that pipe out to this blood-filled venous area. Cavernous sinus, a big open area. Rete, a network of vessels. So then you get this heat exchange through the wall, the solid wall, by conduction. But when fluid is moving, that's convection. And then here is evaporation. There's the three mechanisms operating in this picture. Evaporation, flow would be convection, and conduction through the solid walls. Quite a mechanism. The ovine carotid rete. Found in camels as well, maybe not as good, and then not found in some animals. Excellent diagram from our textbook, right? Probably, Brianna, where are you? Did you work Google? Thank you, you're using the same textbook as I am. Okay, now I want to take some temperatures, body temperatures, and I'm gonna use this thing. That's an infrared thermometer. It's just like when you go to the physician and somebody sticks that little device in your ear. They're taking the temperature of the tympanic membrane. You know, that's the eardrum. Tympanic membrane with infrared detection. And it doesn't take any light, any visible light. It works in the dark. So in the infrared zone, the color that this thing sees is directly related to temperature, okay? And you can do this for a whole house. That's if you run a heating and cooling business, you have one of these that takes a picture of a house. And by color, you can see where the house is losing heat in the wintertime especially, okay? So I'm gonna go along to the people in the front row, and I'm just gonna show you how fast it works and the differences in body temperature. I need that arm. 87.6. Now you might want to write it down just to see the difference. 86.8. I want this area right here.
Oh, okay.
Listen, 92. Do you know why I did that? She was like this. And then I took this temperature because I knew that was going to be warmer than this temperature. See? 92, right? 91. 87.5. Cool-hearted. Okay. 86.8. 91.6. You don't mind if I use your body. 85 on that leg. Okay, then let me do the forehead. That was 92. 95.6 on the forehead. Not too bad. Look how fast that was. I didn't have a dry bulb thermometer and I had to wait for something to equilibrate. These are fantastic. If you ever work with animals or machinery, and I was going to have somebody get up and then I was going to take the temperature of the seat because, you know, there's conduction going on there, but I thought maybe not. We're recording this and, you know, how that works. If you ever work with machinery, oh, you've got to have one of these. Because if some bearings are going out, that's hotter. Or if a brake is sticking on your truck, you just go like this and compare it to the other side because they should be about equal. It's amazing what you can do with this. Okay, that's one thing I wanted to show you. You can do a whole house, and it comes up. You can take a picture. This thing was probably $100, $200. The ones that take a picture of a body, you could take a picture of a cow or a horse or an animal. They're in the thousands, because then you get a little printout of color thing and it's more expensive. Okay, now the next thing I want to do, because I want to make sure I do the most important stuff first here, is I want to go to this document cam and talk about factors that affect each of our heat transfer mechanisms. Because you know, if you got to know this. So I'm going to say, and I'll write conduction here, and then I'll look at it, see where I'm at. I'm up there. Okay. So I want to give you the factors that affect heat transfer by conduction. Because we've alluded to them all, but we had never put them down in one spot. Effective surface area. And, it's coming up. Okay, effective surface area. That means how much surface is conducting the heat. So, like, remember the ovine carotid artery? The more of those brown vessels, the more surface area in that cavernous sinus, right? So if you want a good carotid reading, you have a lot of the pipes coming through. If you have a less number of pipes, you have less effective surface area. Okay, and of course you remember conduction is heat transfer through solid objects, right? I'm not going to write that down. Thermal conductivity. Sometimes called the thermal conductivity of the conductor. And by the way, you might want to put behind this is fixed, especially for solid objects. Like pipes, you could look it up if it's cast iron or if it's aluminum or copper or whatever, that's probably cast iron. You can look up the conductivity of that metal and that will never change. Okay? So that means how good of a conductor is it? And what's the opposite of a good conductor? A good insulator. So they're kind of opposites. If you don't conduct, you insulate. So when you build a house, you insulate the walls and the ceiling. And what's that value? You buy the insulation, and then right on the bag it says, there's a number, but it starts out with a letter, R, the R value. I'm not sure if R stands for resistance to heat flow, but it wouldn't be a bad thing to remember, right? The higher the number, the better the insulation. And it's not always the thickness, because it depends on the material. Okay, then thermal gradient. Another way of saying is differential in temperature. If you have two pieces of material and they're at the same temperature, then there's no heat flow, no net heat flow. But the greater the difference, the greater the amount of heat flow, right? Per minute, per second, whatever. So thermal gradient. And then when things are conducting, like I didn't have my coffee cup today, but if you have your hand on a coffee cup, the coffee cup is usually warmer if the coffee's cooked right. But then if you held it long enough, the surface of the coffee cup and the surface of your hand would be at the same temperature. That's what it wants to do. It's going down this way. Okay, so that's conduction. Now remember, conduction is solid objects, but don't forget about still water. That's considered a solid object if it's not moving. Like a tank of water, like a coffee cup, that would be good. It's not really moving. There might be some internal little currents, but in general, it's not moving. So by conduction, the heat is transferring from the coffee to the coffee cup. Okay, that's conduction. Let's do convection. And I'm leaking through there, but that's okay. Now, you know, this is the mass transfer of material. It could be air, it could be water, but something's got to be flowing, blood. Convection. And of course, in the wintertime, we say wind chill, right? It's a good indication. Okay, factors. Effective surface area. That's going to be kind of a common theme. How much area is being exposed? Now, if you have short sleeves on today, then you know, your arms can lose heat and there's a greater surface area. But if you have long sleeves, that's covered up, right? And you have less effective surface area. Okay. Velocity. Velocity of the medium. And the good example is wind chill. The higher the wind speed at any given temperature, wind chill, the temperature goes down. Then thermal gradient. And that means the temperature differential. So in the winter, the air is at a certain temperature, let's say 10 degrees. But if somebody says the wind chill is minus 20 degrees out there, you would never find minus 20. You can't. It's a man-made construct, basically. So a tree that's not any different in temperature than the wind coming at it doesn't feel the minus 20. The minus 20 wind chill is telling you how much heat you will lose. It'd be like walking into a minus 20 freezer. So there's a great thermal difference. Okay, so that's convection, effective surface area, velocity of whatever you're talking about. It could be blood, could be wind, could be water. And then maybe on the same one, I'll do radiation. And you know, those three, including radiation, those are the sensible heat transfer mechanisms, right? Sensible heat transfer mechanism. And radiation, and all these things could be, thermal could be put in front of it. Thermal conduction, thermal convection, thermal radiation, to maybe make that point. Okay, effective surface area. So that's been a common thing. I'll do SA, that's surface area. So the best example, of course, is out on a sunny day in the wintertime. If you want to warm up, the more surface area you can expose to the sun. Or, and then here's a kicker. Everything above absolute zero is emitting some electromagnetic waves, okay? So everything above absolute zero. So when I walk over this wall, it's emitting something to me, but it depends on the temperature difference, right? So that's another thing, temperature difference. But the wall sees my side view here, right? How do I increase surface area? Yeah, like give it my best side. Okay? So that's, see how you can, it saw the side view, but then if I turn, just by turning, it saw a bigger surface area. So effective surface area, temperature difference, thermal gradient again, another way of saying that. So if the wall was the same temperature as my surface, then there would be no net heat flow. But let me check the temperature of the wall. 72, oh, I'm warm too, 92. So I'm looking, I'm moving, right? And by the way, that's a great source of heat, muscle movement, right? You can increase your heat production tenfold by running. 10 times basal, basically. So I'm the only one that's moving, right? Basically, my diaphragm is moving more than yours, all this stuff, okay. Okay, effective surface area, thermal gradient, and then a weird thing. Color, right? Nothing else. I mean, it's weird, but black absorbs the most radiant heat, and it also emits the most. So a black cow in the summer, in the sunny day, will absorb more heat from the sun than a white cow, but at night, she'll give off more heat. Okay, so black is the greatest color for absorption, and white is the greatest color for reflection, right? And then you got all these other things between. So remember, all bodies above absolute zero emit these electromagnetic waves. Okay, then we'll go to evaporation, our fourth little thing, factor. I might be off the screen, but I'll look here. Evaporation. I'm up. There we go. Evaporation. And then you might like, okay, draw a line because this is different now. This is latent heat transfer, insensible heat transfer. Well, lo and behold, effective surface area still plays a role. So like an overheated horse, if you use rubbing alcohol on a square foot versus 5 square feet, you're going to get more evaporation and a, more of a cooling effect if you increase the surface area. The carotid rete in sheep, the nasal cavity, the more surface area that blood is close to the evaporation, the better. And then surface temperature. Because the higher the temperature, the more likely the molecules of water, in our case, will escape from the surface, right? They're going from the liquid to a vapor, and that's an escape. And then the only factor that has this, the only heat transfer mechanism that has this factor, humidity. So that's like that swamp cooler again. Swamp coolers don't work at all if it's 100% humid outside. They work great if it's 10% humid out there. Okay, anybody have any questions on that? And then I'm missing one, condensation, but you know, condensation is the total opposite of this, right? So instead of water, liquid going to a vapor, it's vapor going to a solid. And let's see, for evaporation, when water is evaporating, it takes 580 calories per gram of water to evaporate. So you can measure heat in calories. So if you lose, if a surface loses 580 calories per gram of water that's evaporated, during condensation, how many calories does that surface gain? 580, because they're just totally opposite processes. Okay, then, make a new little. I want to talk about dry bulb temperature versus wet bulb temperature. You write that down, and while you're writing that down, I'm going to see if I can find a little diagram. Dry bulb versus wet bulb. Okay. So, I guess it's our third kind of chart, right? We had wind chill, then we had temperature humidity index, and now we've got dry bulb, wet bulb temperature. Okay, let's do this one here. Okay, now here it is. You know, like the regular thermometers that you can like take rectal temperature. That's called a dry bulb thermometer, by the way. You know, the rectal thermometer. It's, you know, it's a liquid enclosed. It used to be mercury. It's probably not mercury now, but it's a liquid enclosed and it's got a little scale. Okay, that's dry bulb temperature. When you do wet bulb temperature, what happens is there's a device that's just like that, except around the bulb at the bottom, there's like, let's say, a sock that's wet. Wet bulb. And then you spin that in the air that you're at. Okay? So the dry bulb, it just sits there and it will equilibrate over time. The wet bulb is you take this same similar device, you put a wet little sock around the bulb, and then you spin it. And if there's no evaporation, the temperature of the dry bulb equals the wet bulb. and you have 100% humidity in that room. So you can determine percent humidity by the difference in the reading of the dry bulb versus the wet bulb. So dry bulb, it's just that regular thermometer you're used to, like a rectal thermometer. The wet bulb's got some water on a sock around it, and if you spin it and it's dry, it would decrease the temperature, right? Can you see that? Because the water would evaporate from that sock, and then that would draw thermal energy away from the bulb, right? The little bulb at the bottom of the thermometer. So if it's less than 100% humidity, you get some evaporation, and then the wet bulb temperature would go down, and the dry bulb would stay the same, okay? So if they're the same, 100% humidity. If the wet bulb temperature is lower than the dry bulb, then it's not 100% humidity. And basically, that's what this chart is. So see the difference between wet and dry bulb temperatures? So if there's no difference, you have 100%, which I just said. And so then the more difference you have, the relative humidity. So there's 100% humidity, and then you can go decrease. So like this is Indiana in the summertime, that's Phoenix over there, right? Dry bulb. So if you ever hear that, dry bulb temperature versus wet bulb temperature. Okay. Let me do one last thing. I want to do some temperatures. I want to convert C to F. You know, when I was in college, I didn't have a textbook that would do this for me. It's amazing. Let's see. Okay. So there's one right there that's on my page. 0C equals 32 Fahrenheit. And then we know minus 40 is minus 40. And then we want to do, and actually I'm going to go over here because I'm not sure what it is on C. 68 Fahrenheit equals 20 C. And the reason I picked that out is sometimes when you do signs, or in fact, if you ever write up a scientific article, you never use Fahrenheit, right? You use degree C. And 68 is your standard room temperature. So, and sometimes in the scientific literature, it's capital R, capital T. The experiment was conducted at normal room temperature, RT. 68 Fahrenheit, 20 Celsius. One thing that some people don't appreciate, it's a little sidebar here, is when you sell, and I guess I can give you a real example. Years ago, Eli Lilly bought this, I don't think they bought the company, but they bought a kit from the company that did milk progesterone. That's pretty handy. So if you're a dairy producer and you want to know if the cow's pregnant or the stage of the estrous cycle and there's some problems with it, but you know, milk is being sampled twice a day. That's a lot simpler than getting a blood sample. You're right there at the udder level. You can get a few drops of milk, put it in this test kit, and it would tell you progesterone. And one of these steps in it is let incubate at this step, let's say 15 minutes at room temperature. Well, where's room temperature found when it's January and the wind's blowing and it's 10 degrees outside and you're in the barn? Is there room temperature around any place? The standard room temperature? Probably not. So there's two things to notice. Enzymes function. The higher the temperature in the range, the higher the metabolic, the higher the rate of the reaction. So this kit said, you know, measure this, get the milk, blah blah blah, incubate this step at room temperature for 15 minutes. Well, a lot of people didn't understand that was 68, and they were getting false results. They were either, and I can't remember which way it was, but the point is, They were getting false readings because the enzymatic reaction was not allowed to be taking place. So there's a problem with that. So that's the standard room temperature, 68 Fahrenheit, 20 C. Of course, 212 is 100. So I think that's kind of standard ones. The minus 40 and minus 40 is interesting. The 0 and 32, the room temperature, and then this one. Okay. Let's see what else I have in my notepad here for the day. Did that. Okay, I want to make one comment about lower critical temperatures. Remember, the thermal neutral zone is on the left, lower critical temperature, on the right, upper critical temperature, right? And that's your comfort zone. In animals, we call it thermal neutral zone. And you can experimentally determine the LCT. You put an animal in a metabolic chamber, and if heat production increases, that's that y-axis, oxygen consumption by the animal increases because metabolism is getting faster and more heat's being produced. Heat is a byproduct of metabolism. And then they can calculate the lower critical temperature. And that's how it's done, and there's books and whatever. And I told you for dairy cattle and piglets, they're like totally crazy opposites. And the same animal can vary in its LCT. Like you can take a sheep that has a lot of fleece and it'll have a certain LCT. But as soon as you start decreasing fleece length, you increase the lower critical temperature. Can you see that? You decrease the fleece length, you increase lower critical temperature. Lower critical temperature, if I increase it, that means it slides to the right. Okay? So that's one thing. If you feed an animal more, that decreases the LCT. The same animal, you, me, a sheep out on the farm. The more food you give it, the lower its LCT is because it's got a lot of metabolism. It's got all that energy that it can burn, okay? So now, I'll never ask you a question about the upper critical temperature because that's harder to establish. And so I know, and Ethan and I worked on that quiz together, right? He does the rough question. Is it running, the new quiz that I told you about? Okay. Anyway, I'll never ask you. Ethan had made a question. Oh, I know what it was, and I want to. This is for Ethan and everybody in the room. Ethan had a question about what is the upper critical temperature of a dairy cow? And the answer was 70. I'm not sure. Here's what I said about 70. As soon as it reaches 70, you start worrying about your cows and you can put fans on and stuff. But I'm not sure if that's the official upper critical temperature because it's not really it's really hard to establish versus the lower critical temperature. So if you ever read books in environmental physiology, they'll have tables of lower critical temperature because they've done the experiments, but you'll never see a table of upper critical temperatures because it's harder to establish that. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Wednesday, G126, is our proctor coming? And I heard she was a bad girl the other day.
Yeah, she was. Okay. Well, she's really bad. Her and Midas.
Yeah, her and Midas. We will come.
They went on a road.
And then do I have to see you at 10:30?
Yeah.
10:30?
Yeah.
Okay. 10:30 handoff?
Well, they let them out, but they just have to go out there.
Okay. See you Wednesday.
No, they don't really know. We have no idea.